So thank you so much for the introduction and for having me here. It's a real pleasure to get to know your work and get to know the Beckman Institute. So before I start this talk, actually, I'm going to walk around, and I want to, since the audience is very manageable size, please feel free to interrupt me at any time. Hopefully, I can clarify things, and you can ask questions as you go along. I think that would maybe is the way to go. And before I start the talk, I wanted to acknowledge everybody who contributed to the work that I'm going to present today. The vast majority of the work was done while I was still at Harvard in the group of Federico Capasso. And it was done with a lot of colleagues and collaborators, both at Harvard and MIT and elsewhere. And actually, a lot of them have now since moved on to potentially greener pastures, and they're actually kind of scattered all over the world now in various companies, research institutes, and universities. So the motivation for my talk is the fact that many times in optics, we deal with what we call bulk optics. So for example, you might think of compound lenses, you might think of single lenses, of Fresnel lenses that are very large, of prisms and whatnot. And all of these components are rather large. They're rather thick. They're rather heavy. Whenever you build these big optical systems, they become very heavy and very large. And the question that we asked ourselves at one point is there a way to try to make them lighter, make them thinner, make them smaller, to be able to still regain some functionality? So the vision for everything that I'm going to present today is the creation of new optical components that can augment or even replace a lot of these traditional optical components, such as these guys over here, but that are instead very, very thin, very flat, very light, and then also potentially tunable. And in particular, there's some motivation in doing this for spectral ranges that are outside of the visible. Because in the visible, we've gotten very good at making optical components. We've gotten very good at machining materials and making them very flat, very smooth, precisely the right shape, making aspheric lenses, things like that. But in other spectral ranges, for example, in the mid-infrared, so these guys over here are zinc selenide lenses that are made for the mid-infrared, optical components are still quite expensive. You know, an order of magnitude more expensive than the same ones in the visible. They're still not very good. They're often made out of materials that are toxic, that are difficult to polish, and so there's a lot of room to be able to improve optics and spectral ranges that are outside of the visible. And that's a big motivation for the type of work that I'm going to present today. So what we use in order to be able to make some of these ultra-thin components are structures that we call metasurfaces. And the way that we define metasurfaces are optically thin arrays of elements, such as resonators, antennas, and so forth, that each one of them have a sub-wavelength size, so they're smaller than the wavelength, and they also have small a sub-wavelength spacing in between them. So when you combine this, we call the resulting structure a metasurface. So the talk today is going to be split into two parts. The first part is going to be a little bit of an introduction. So we're going to discuss how we put together these metasurfaces and some very simple examples. Bending light with metasurfaces, making very thin, very flat lenses, making spiral phase plates. And this is actually all work that is now a few years old. So it first came out, you know, maybe 2, 3, 4 years ago, and there's been some progress on this front ever since. And then the second part of this talk is I want to talk about really some ongoing work and some challenges and some opportunities. And it turns out that those can be broken down into a few different directions. For example, we can talk about the efficiency, how much light, like what kind of light throughput that we get through these optical structures. Talk about multi-wavelength operation. How can we make these guys broadband and be able to operate at multiple wavelengths simultaneously? And then finally, dynamic tunability. Can we make an optical element that you press a button and it turns into a different optical element with very, very high speed? So the example that I want to talk about kind of to motivate the work is that of a conventional refractive lens. So if you have a conventional refractive lens, you have a wavefront that's planar, for example, that's coming in from the bottom, and it's incident on this structure, which is curved, and has a higher index than its surrounding the surrounding medium, for example, glass and air. And you end up getting a phase delay, which is larger in the middle than you do on the outside. And therefore, you convert a phase front, which is planar, which is flat, into a wavefront. Into a wavefront that is curved, and therefore you end up getting a convergent point, and this lens focuses. So in general, almost all conventional optical elements, such as this lens, rely on gradual phase accumulation through dielectric transparent media, and therefore there's kind of a thickness limitation that's associated with making a refractive optical component that works well. And that limitation is that this thickness has to be at least approximately the wavelength or thicker, and for some applications that's too thick and ends up being too heavy and not compact enough for certain optical systems. So the question then is, can we make thinner optics? So the motivation for metasurfaces in particular was actually a very old principle that describes how light propagates through materials, and that's called Huygens' principle. So in Huygens' principle, imagine, for example, that you have an interface between two different materials, and you have a wave front that's coming in from the bottom. So you have a wave that's incident on this interface, and you want to ask what happens. Well, we know what's going to happen. We know that light is going to be transmitted because it's at normal incidence, and there's also going to be some reflections. But one way to see that is to imagine that every single point on this interface can be viewed as a secondary emitter of light. So you maybe can imagine every single one of these atoms as temporarily absorbing the incident wave front and then re-emitting it, and then each one of them is going to kind of output a spherical wave. And so these secondary wavelets then interfere and form a plane wave that continues on. So that's a kind of a simple and very old way of understanding wave propagations, or in this case, transmission through an interface. So the question then is it possible to engineer Huygens' principle? Could we, for example, take this interface and prescribe the phase to every single one of these secondary emitters such that we control the phase of these little spherical secondary wavelets? Because if we can, then we can turn this interface into an optical component. For example, if we have a phase that's delayed in the middle with respect to the phase of the secondary wavelet on the outside, then this forms a converging wavefront, and then once again we can get some sort of lensing behavior. So this would be somehow an interface lens, right? A very flat, very thin interface with no curvature to it that can nonetheless focus light the same way that a conventional lens would. So if we could do that, if that's something that we're able to engineer and make, then this could be seen as introducing discontinuities in the optical wavefront, right? Because over here you have a wave, and then all of a sudden, at every single one of these points, you maintain the frequency of light, you maintain everything except for you switch the phase in an instant in a very, very thin region. And so what we call that is a phase discontinuity. You have light with one frequency and one phase over here and the same frequency over here, but the phase has been altered. And if we can engineer that, that's something that we can make, then we can turn the interface into any optical component that we want. So the next logical question then is, how would we implement such a phase discontinuity? How do we actually make this in practice? And what we end up using for this is we end up using optical antennas. So antennas typically come in two flavors, at least in radio frequencies and in microwave frequencies. They come as in the flavor of receiving antennas and transmitting antennas. A receiving antenna is an antenna that's connected to a circuit, and the antenna absorbs some incident radiation, which launches some electron oscillation, and you pick off that electron oscillation in a circuit, and therefore you're able to detect light. And the transmitting antenna, of course, is the opposite. You use the circuit to generate the electron oscillation in the antenna, and then that radiates light so that you're able to transmit. But it turns out that at very, very high frequencies, for example, at visible frequencies, we don't have any circuits that are that fast. So we can't use antennas in either of these two conventional configurations. And instead, what we use is antennas that are simultaneously receiving and transmitting. So we take some sort of chunk of metal that's shaped in a certain way. It absorbs some incident radiation temporarily. Electrons start oscillating, then they re-radiate the light, and then the light comes out. And of course, that process is known in optics as scattering. So this is scattering from an optical antenna. Now, one straightforward way to understand antennas, for example, if you just take a metal rod and you put it on a substrate and then you see what happens, is you can view it actually as a damped driven harmonic oscillator. Because you can imagine that you have electrons that you can move back and forth due to the incident field, and then there's some restoring forces that act on the electrons. And therefore, you have a restoring force and a driving force, and you can write down an equation essentially of a harmonic oscillator. And a harmonic oscillator has an amplitude response and a phase response. So for example, the scattering and absorption cross sections would vary like this as a function of the wavelength around some sort of resonant wavelength, and correspondingly, the phase of the scattered light is also going to vary around the resonant wavelength of the antenna, the same way that it would that the phase of any oscillator varies with respect to its detuning from resonance. So you find this curve in simple harmonic oscillators, in physics 101, and masses on springs, and pendula, and so forth. So if an antenna is an oscillator, or if the scattering from an antenna can be described as scattering by a harmonic oscillator, and this guy has an amplitude response and it has a phase response, then presumably you could sit at one particular wavelength or one particular frequency. Now I'm in the frequency domain, but it doesn't matter too much. I sit at one particular frequency and I change the shape of my antenna. So for example, let's say I make it longer and shorter. I take my rod and I make it longer or shorter, and what that does is it changes the resonant frequency of the antenna. And as long as I'm sitting at one particular wavelength, then I'm seeing antennas that have a different phase response at that particular wavelength or that particular frequency, depending on the antenna shape. So I could have a longer antenna and this phase, and I could have a shorter antenna, and then I have this phase at that particular driving frequency. And so therefore, by just switching the geometry or switching the size of this antenna, we can gain control of the phase of the scattered light. And in this case, our maximum phase coverage is about pi, because the phase coverage of a simple harmonic oscillator is about pi. So of course, that's not enough, right? If we want to engineer Huygens' principle and give us a way to build any optical component out of this modified Huygens principle, we need to be able to control the phase up to 2 pi, anywhere within 2 pi, because phase is defined modulo 2 pi. And so it turns out that what we need to do is we need to start cascading resonances. Instead of having just one resonance and being able to sweep from 0 to pi, we can have multiple resonances. For example, we can have these more complicated antennas which allow multiple modes of charge oscillation. For example, in this case, we could have charges oscillating symmetrically in and out from this vertex, or asymmetrically with respect to this vertex. And it turns out that when you cascade these resonances, you can get a phase response that's extended from that of a simple harmonic oscillator. So what we get at the end, then, is we can design an array of structures. We can design a set of structures, in this case, 8 antennas of different shapes, each one that has a scattering phase that's offset from each other one by essentially 2 pi over 8, so pi over 4. So this guy has been designed to scatter light with a phase that's pi over 4 off from this guy that's pi over 4 from this guy, and so forth. And over here, you can see simulations of it doing just that. So this is these are antennas that are about a micron in size, and this is light that has a wavelength of 8 microns. It's incident from the bottom, and then it hits one of these guys that's sitting at this interface. This is an interface between silicon and air, because silicon is transparent at 8 microns. And you can see that the scattered phase is gradually increasing depending on which antenna is sitting at the interface. Right? So what you can do then, if you have antennas that have a uniform scattering amplitude and a controlled phase response between 0 and 2 pi, is you can design structure, you can design an interface that's going to give you refraction that's different from conventional refraction, right? Because here you can send light in at normal incidence from the bottom, and you can design your scatterers, you can place them in an array where the phase gradually increases as you go in, along the interface, and therefore you can scatter light at an angle. And so we call this effect anomalous refraction, because it's refraction that follows a generalized refraction law that's a little bit different from the conventional Snell's law. And this is what one of these structures actually looks like when we make it and measure it. So this is an array that's been defined using electron beam lithography of these antennas. And you can see the 8 antennas. So this is kind of our phase discretization. And we repeat that over and over again to create this phase gradient over here. And this ends up working quite well and ends up bending light in the direction that we want. So now that we have that, right? Now that we have individual scatterers whose phase we can control, we can then start to reproduce the response of many different optical components. So for example, we could think about making a lens using this interface effect, making an axicon, making a spiral phase plate, making wave plates, because it turns out that these guys have some anisotropy and they allow us to control the polarization of the scattered light as well. So During this talk, I want to show you just two of these examples. I'm going to show you some lenses, and I'm going to show you how you make spiral phase plates, and also the experimental confirmations of the fact that these guys work. So for example, let's say you wanted to make a lens, right? So you wanted to make an interface version of a simple curved refractive lens. Then what you would need is you would need a bunch of these little Huygens sources, right, everywhere along the interface, here, 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 and so forth. And you want every one of them to have a different phase response, and the phase response should follow some sort of function that varies away from the center of the flat lens. In fact, if you do a calculation, it turns out that the best focusing you get is when you have this hyperboloid shape of the phase response. So it starts in the middle and then it goes as you go away, further and further away from the surface. So in this case, we're plotting the phase kind of continuously from 0 to 12 radians. So our implementation looks as follows. So on the right, you see kind of the design. We've discretized the phase that we want on our lens in units of pi over 4, just to have to create kind of an infinite number of different types of scatters. We just want to create 8 and then be able to tile them over and over and over again. And so this is the phase response that's necessary in order to make a focusing lens. And then on the left, you have a very zoomed out scanning electron microscope image of the structure that we actually made using e-beam lithography. And this is actually a lens that's about a centimeter in diameter. If you think about it, this took quite a bit of electron beam lithography, if you're familiar with e-beam lithography, because this was a structure that's about a centimeter in diameter. It's a very large e-beamed structure. And if you zoom in, then this is what you see. So in this case, our structures are smaller than the ones that I showed you before, because we designed this lens to operate at a wavelength of 1.5 microns instead of 8 microns, so well in the near-infrared at the telecom band. So you can see that the antennas are significantly smaller, but they're still gold antennas on top of a silicon substrate. So if you like, if you can view this as like a digital Fresnel lens or like a blazed Fresnel zone plate. So if you're familiar with the diffractive optics, you'll recognize that this looks an awful lot like a Fresnel lens or a Fresnel zone plate, but it works on a slightly different principle, and it's also very, very flat and very, very thin, at least compared to Fresnel lenses. So we did some experiments to confirm that this guy works and that you actually get good focusing behavior from this lens. The experiment is very, very simple. You just essentially take a laser and you shine it at your structure, and it's going to focus somewhere, right? There's going to be a focus somewhere. In this case, we designed our focus to be 3 centimeters away from our lens, and then we raster scan our detector with a pinhole in front of it, and to be able to essentially map out the field, map out the intensity of light as a function of position. And we see this is the calculation, this is what should have been, what's predicted for this lens, and this is the measured cross section, in this case along just one of the dimensions, along the plane that's within the screen. And you can see that it works quite well, that you do have your lens over here, and you get very good focusing behavior. So it works. One nice thing about this is that because you have direct access to the phase front, you're just imprinting the phase profile that you want onto your incident wave, you can avoid certain monochromatic aberrations by design. So for example, there's no such thing as like a spherical aberration because our structure is not a sphere. We've directly imprinted the phase front that we need in order to get the focusing that we want. And the entire lens is only 50 nanometers thick and completely flat and can be made with a single step of lithography. So lenses have a radial phase ramp, right? Like the phase increases away from the center of the lens. And something pretty interesting happens if you, instead of having a radial phase ramp, you have an azimuthal phase ramp, where you have a structure where you divide it into sections and you change your phase as you go around the center point, right? So if you have a section of your phase plate that has one phase and a different phase and a different phase and so forth, and you kind of rotate around in a circle. So if you shine a plane wave or a Gaussian beam through one of these phase plates, then what you generate on the other side is something that's called an optical vortex or an optical vortex beam. Now this is light that has a very interesting phase front. The phase front is actually corkscrew shaped. So if you take a look, it's corkscrew shaped like this. And if you want to write down the expression for the electric field, you'll see that it's essentially more or less proportional to a plane wave term multiplied by a term where your phase varies as you go around the center of the beam. And what you do is you can assign essentially the number of times, the number of turns that you make within a single wavelength, and that's this number here, L, and in the field of optical vortices or singular optics, this is called the topological charge. So this L is sometimes called the topological charge. And what's very interesting about these beams is that optical vortices actually carry orbital angular momentum. So every photon of light that's shaped in this way carries orbital angular momentum. And the amount of orbital angular momentum that it carries is quantized, and the number is L. So you could have orbital angular momentum of LH bar, 2LH bar, 3LH bar, all the way up to a really big number, up to infinity. And so this is quite interesting because light is generally known to carry spin angular momentum, right? If you have circularly polarized light, you know that those photons have a certain amount of spin angular momentum, but there can only be two values, right? There's either either right circularly polarized light or left circularly polarized light, and so therefore there's only two kind of angular momentum states that are allowed for a photon. Whereas if you take into account orbital angular momentum, you can have an infinite amount of orbital angular momentum states, and this becomes interesting in terms of, for example, multiplexing for telecommunication systems. So if you can send light down one mode which has one topological charge and another mode that has another topological charge, those two guys are orthogonal, and therefore that's like two communications channels that propagate along the same direction in one free space beam. So this is quite interesting, and there's a lot of work going on right now in terms of making telecommunication systems that utilize the orbital degree of freedom of light. So this is the experiment that demonstrates the fact that these guys can generate optical vortices. So you have a laser, and it's incident on one of these structures. This is kind of what it looks like. This is a fabricated structure. I've now bounced back to the 8-micron wavelength. We kind of try to do this at various wavelengths. So 8 microns turns out to be a pretty interesting wavelength in the mid-infrared, and we happen to have good optical sources at that wavelength in our laboratory. And so this is a quantum cascade laser that's designed to operate at 8 microns. This is kind of a simplistic diagram, but essentially we shine it onto this faceplate, and then we detect the result with a mid-infrared camera, just with a detector all the way at the end. And what we see, this is an experimental result, and this is a simulation result. What we see is a donut beam, a donut intensity pattern. And that's precisely what you would expect for a vortex beam. Because if the phase of this slice is one value, and the phase of this slice is another value, in fact, it's offset exactly by pi, then there can't be any amplitude in the middle because you have a phase singularity, right? You come in from different sides, you don't know what the phase is of light at that center, and therefore your intensity has to be zero. So you have to have a donut beam. Of course, this is not very conclusive evidence that you have an optical vortex beam, because in principle you could make a donut-shaped beam that doesn't have this weird corkscrew phase, right? And so what we have to do in order to figure out that it really is an optical vortex beam is we need to do an interference experiment. So we split off our light before our sample over here, and we build kind of a little Maxender interferometer, where you're breaking off your light over here. So a portion of that light goes to the sample, but a portion of it does not. And then you recombine the two beams, and then you image this with your mid-infrared camera again. And what you see, this is an experiment and this is the calculation, is you see the interferogram, right? You're seeing the interference between this corkscrew-shaped beam and a regular Gaussian beam that has no corkscrew at all, and therefore you see an interferogram that has the spiral phase. And this is conclusive evidence that what we have coming out of this after this faceplate over here is an optical vortex beam. Okay, so one thing that's pretty interesting is what happens immediately after this faceplate, immediately after this metasurface, right? So these are simulations that are done using the finite difference time domain method, FDTD. It's a full wave simulation technique that allows us to do complex electromagnetic calculations in three dimensions. And over here, we're recording the amplitude and the phase of the light that just went through this interface immediately above the interface. So 0.2 microns away from the interface, 1 micron away, 2 microns away, 3.5, and 8 microns away for a wavelength of 8 microns. So this is one wavelength away, and this is closer than one wavelength away. And what's interesting is that you end up forming your desired phase front, so the spiral phase front, you end up forming it only lambda over 8, 1/8 of a wavelength away from your interface. So essentially, you're just directly imprinting the phase that you want onto your wavefront, which is different, for example, compared to diffractive optics, where you're your optical component can be quite flat because you just have opaque and transparent regions, but you need to be in some sort of a far field zone, right? You need to be in like the Fraunhofer far field zone, and therefore your full kind of optical component, where it's the structure plus the distance you have to propagate, has to be rather large. Whereas over here, we have a direct imprinting, and you get the wavefront that you want directly after your metasurface. So now, how am I doing on time? I'm at 24 minutes. Now I wanted to come to kind of an intermission. So everything that I showed you up until now is actually, at this point, results that are about 3 years old, anywhere between 2 and 3.5 years old. And since then, there's been quite a bit of activity in this field, both by us and our colleagues, but also by a number of different research groups in the US and around the world. And also now there's been some interest from industry as well. So in general, metasurface-based flat optics I think it's fair to say it's a young field with a lot of interest. So I put one of these citation plots over here that I normally don't like because it's a little bit self-serving, but this is like the number of citations that mention, you know, metasurfaces as a function of year, and you can clearly see that there's a huge spike. This is an interesting growing field. But this is a little bit self-serving in that you could have a lot of citations and have this guy never go anywhere, never become useful technology, never become a useful thing. And so it's fair to ask the question, can metasurfaces ever augment or even replace conventional optical components? Are there benefits to them? Can we make them that with superior performance in some way? And so in principle, the answer is yes, right? Because there's some big benefits versus, for example, conventional refractive optics. You can imagine that they're much thinner, so there's a thickness benefit. They're much lighter. They can be made with single-step fabrication that doesn't require you to kind of machine complicated shapes, so that could be a benefit. You can, in principle, have sub-wavelength resolution in terms of the phase that you can impart on your optical phase front, which may be beneficial. And in principle, you can have dynamic tunability, and we'll talk about that at the very end, which could be nice. In particular, it's hard to imagine metasurface optics overcoming the performance of conventional optical components in the visible because, well, refractive optics have had a bit of a head start, and people have gotten pretty good at making them. But outside of the visible spectrum, where a lot of optical components have not yet been so well developed, you can imagine metasurfaces making an impact. For example, a lot of the work that I've done and that I've showed you has been in the mid-infrared spectral range. So for example, wavelengths like 8 microns and 10 microns, where it's much easier to kind of match the performance of existing refractive optical components. So the flip side of that is there's a lot of problems. There's a lot of issues that need to be overcome before these guys can really become useful. But we can also call these opportunities, right? You know, places where we can really make an impact, where more research is needed. And there's really three things that need to be improved or need to be introduced to metasurfaces to really make them competitive and make them useful. That's make them have very high efficiency, so you don't lose any light. Reduce chromatic aberrations, make them work very well for a wide range of wavelengths, and then also introduce dynamic tunability. Make optical components that you press a button and you're able to change the behavior of an optical component from something to something else. For example, if it's a lens, change the focal length, or maybe even turn a lens into some other kind of faceplate and so forth. So the first issue that I wanted to explore is metasurface efficiency. So, sorry, I'm going to walk over here because I'm hiding. So, the way that we define metasurface efficiency is how much of the light that is incident on our structure does what we want it to do, right? So if it's a lens, how much of the light ends up in the focus? If it steers light in some direction, how much of the light gets steered in some direction instead of going somewhere else, being reflected, being absorbed, and so forth? And it turns out that these first examples of metasurfaces were actually quite inefficient. So this paper that we ended up publishing actually had an efficiency of about 1%. 1% of the light went into the focus, and 99% of the light went somewhere else. It was either absorbed or reflected or scattered or depolarized or something else. So that's not very good for most applications, right? And there are a lot of sources of inefficiency. So for example, in this case, because I didn't want to do e-beam writing of such a big structure for, you know, hundreds of hours, we had a relatively low packing efficiency, right? We didn't pack them very, very tightly together. And so in principle, that's easy to fix. You can just make more of them, right? You can pack them tighter. That's fine. Another source of inefficiency is optical absorption in metals, right? Because we have metallic structures, and we have optical absorption losses that can be between 5 and 40% in the visible and the infrared, because metals are lossy at these frequencies. We have a lot of light that's reflected. You can imagine that if you have this metal structure over here, then at this interface between the dielectric and the metal, you have a lot of reflection, right? You have an impedance mismatch, and therefore a lot of the light is not going to go where you want it to go. And then in the case of these particular structures, you also have polarization conversion, but maybe I won't get into that for the sake of this discussion. So it turns out that, you know, the maximum efficiency that you can get by just doing some optimizations of these structures is on the order of 25%, which is starting to be reasonable. It's starting to be useful for some applications, but it's still pretty bad compared to like a lens that you can buy from Thor Labs, right? Or a phase plate that you could buy from Thor Labs. So it turns out that if you operate these in reflection mode, so this is now not work from us, but from some other groups that I want to highlight, in reflection, many of these problems go away. So for example, if you make a metasurface that instead of operating in transmission mode, it's a metasurface that operates in reflection mode. So light comes in and then does what you want over here. Either it gets steered in the right direction, or it gets focused, or it gets converted to a vortex beam or something else. So the reason why many problems in reflection go away is because you lose the issue of impedance mismatch, right? Instead of light being able to transmit and then also reflect, light can only be reflected, and therefore you have less degrees of freedom to optimize. And these structures, if you're familiar with microwave engineering, these structures are actually quite similar to what are known as reflector rays in the microwave range. So in this case, this was a metasurface that had an efficiency of about 80% in reflection mode for wavelengths between 750 and 900 nanometers. So this is getting to be pretty good. In transmission mode, the problem is harder because, as I said, you simultaneously have to somehow overcome the impedance mismatch, right? You have to control your phase of your scatterers so that you don't backreflect light, or you suppress the backreflection of light. But simultaneously, you have to control the phase of the light that's transmitted, right? And that's difficult. You have to optimize those things at the same time. And it turns out that instead of having kind of one layer of a metasurface, if you have several layers, for example, two layers or three layers, then you can actually achieve local control of the scattered phase, or control of the electric and the magnetic fields, and you simultaneously achieve impedance matching. So this is work from Andrea Alou's group in UT Austin, and this is some work from Tony Gerbich's group in the University of Michigan. And in both of these cases, they're showing computationally, but still, that you're able to completely suppress the back-reflected light phase control. So at least in principle, we can think about making metasurfaces that are highly efficient in transmission mode. And if we can combine these approaches with structures that are lossless, so with resonators that are made out of transparent dielectrics rather than out of lossy metals, then in principle this can lead to efficiencies approaching 100%. So this is like a good start. We think that there's hope in terms of getting high efficiencies out of metasurfaces, even though experimentally it's not there yet. So the second problem to overcome, or the second opportunity, is chromatic aberrations, or multi-wavelength operation. So today, if you were to Google Scholar or Web of Science the phrase broadband metasurfaces or broadband metasurface optics, you will find a lot of papers. You will find a lot of results, and you think, oh, this is wonderful. Metasurfaces are broadband. They work in a wide range of wavelengths. And that's not true. And the reason that's not true, and the discrepancy between the names of all of these phenomena, like broadband metasurface holograms, broadband metal lenses, broadband metasurface light bending, and reality, is that what all of these groups have observed and have designed is that you get some effect that is observed over a wide range of wavelengths, but it's not the same effect over a wide range of wavelengths, right? So for example, if you're bending light, you end up bending it at a different angle at every single wavelength, right? So it's like a dispersive element. It's maybe a good thing, but as a piece of achromatic optics or as a piece of broadband optics, it doesn't work at all. So the behavior of all of these is not at all achromatic, and you can view metasurfaces as having a huge amount of dispersion. So there's two reasons for that. There's two reasons why metasurface-based optical elements are very dispersive. The first reason is that we're utilizing resonators, right? And we're sitting, you know, to the right of a resonance, to the left of a resonance, to be able to achieve the phase response that we want. And so this is by definition dispersive, right? By definition, the only reason we're able to get phase control in the first place is because we're using dispersive elements. But then there's a second reason. And the second reason is that in general, any flat optical component is expected to be dispersive even if the individual elements are dispersionless. And that's due to a geometry consideration. So for example, imagine that you wanted to make a flat lens that focuses light to a point, right? So what you need to do is essentially is you need to make all of the paths of light that are allowed to go to that spot constructively interfere, right? So you have light that's coming in like this, and focused like this, and focused like this, and focused, and all of them need to have the same optical phase at the focus, right? You can do that. We know how to engineer the interface for one particular wavelength that allows us to have this condition, because we have control of the phase of light at every point along this interface. But the moment that you go to a different wavelength, your physical path stays the same, but your optical path changes, right? The amount of phase that is accumulated by light from that optical path is different depending on the wavelength at which you're at. So by definition, any flat optical component, no matter what principle it uses, even diffractive optics, you're in general expecting some sort of dispersion. So that's true for metasurfaces, it's true for diffractive optics, it's true for anything that's flat. So the question then is, are we totally out of luck? Do we have no chance because of these two behaviors of making something that works, of making a metasurface that behaves in the same way, that is the same thing for many different wavelengths? And it turns out that the answer is no. There is at least some hope of moving forward. And so the way to see that is, what if we make these two effects, these two reasons for dispersion that are very different, what if we make them fight each other and try to cancel each other out? And in a sense, this is like dispersion compensation, which has been done in optics for a very long time. So, you know, there's things like achromatic doublets and achromatic triplets and super achromatic lenses that allow you to compensate dispersion in such a way that you get ultimately dispersionless behavior. So the way to see that is we go back to our example of a lens, because it's a good one. So if we want a flat lens that works at, for example, three different wavelengths at the same time, so in this case, we're working once again in the near infrared. This is a wavelength of 1.3 microns, 1.5 microns, and 1.8 microns. If we want to design the phase of our interface to get us focusing at the same spot for all three wavelengths, we need to have a different phase response of that interface for those three different wavelengths. So for example, for one wavelength, this is the phase that you need. For another wavelength, you need a different phase. For a different wavelength, you need a third phase curve. And so that means that at every single point on our interface, here, 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 we need to have full control of the phase of light individually for three different wavelengths at the same time, right? And every single one of these points now is different. There's no more tiling that we can do. We can't repeat the same structure over and over again because every single one of these points is now unique. And that seems like something that's very challenging to do. That seems difficult. But it turns out that it can be done, at least to some extent. So what we ended up using is, instead of using metallic antennas as our resonators, we use dielectric resonators. So essentially, we take a high index material. So for example, in this case, it's amorphous silicon, which has a refractive index of about 3.5 at wavelengths between 1.3 and 1.8. And it's a material that's not very lossy. It doesn't absorb a lot of light. And we put that on top of a substrate, which is glass. So you have these high index kind of cubes and shapes like that. And it turns out that these guys can have a rather dense spectrum of optical modes, of optical resonances inside them, that allow us to control the phase of light with pretty high precision across a number of different wavelengths. So if we make a rectangular resonator, and then let's say we put another one next to it, and we look at the coupling between them, we have a lot of degrees of freedom. We have a lot of ways to engineer the phase spectrum. And so it turns out that with a lot of optimization, we're able to make one of these achromatic metasurfaces that works. So this is what this is an electron microscopy image of one of these, what it looks like. So you have a bunch of unit cells. So this is a unit cell, this is a unit cell, this is a unit cell. And you can see that each element is essentially this dielectric rectangular resonator and another dielectric rectangular resonator, and they're coupled. And, you know, by changing the size of them and the coupling between them, we can control the spectrum of the modes that's inside of these resonators. So in this case, we've made just like the metasurface version of a cylindrical lens, because we wanted just to optimize in one dimension. It's much easier to do two-dimensional simulations than it is to do three-dimensional simulations. And so you can see that if you take a look, if this is the lens, right, and light is coming in from the left, and it's being focused to some point, in this case our focal length was designed to be about 7.5 millimeters, and you look at the intensity of the light in the plane of the board at different wavelengths, you can see that at the three wavelengths at which we designed our for which we designed our metasurface, 1300, 1550, and 1800, we actually have pretty good focusing. It works pretty well. So this is, it works well, you know, here, here, and also here. Whereas for all of the other wavelengths, the wavelengths for which we didn't design the metasurface, you can get garbage. Right, you get junk. You get something that is not being focused at all. And so for these three different wavelengths, we actually have pretty good focusing. And it turns out that when you take into account the NA and the size of the lens, this is actually close to diffraction limited focusing. So it's pretty good. These are simulations, but we have corresponding experiments that match them quite well at this point. So kind of to summarize that, and this is a paper that was actually published just last week, so you can take a look if you're interested. To summarize, we've sort of made a set of optical components that are now at least partially achromatic, or at the very least are multi-wavelength. You can do the same thing for several different wavelengths with a very flat, very thin surface that can be made with a single step of lithography. So just OK. So the last topic that I wanted to cover is dynamic tunability. Can we make an optical component that can be changed on the fly from one to another? So that's something that, in principle, can be difficult with a lot of other optical components. For example, changing the focal length of a lens might rely, you could do that if you change the refractive index of the lens in different regions, but it's difficult to do that. It's difficult to induce these large refractive index changes, and it turns out that that's something that metasurfaces are particularly amenable to. So no matter what metasurface you have, you need somewhere to change the refractive index of something, right? That's the way to get tunable optical response. So it turns out that if you have an antenna, like you have a metasurface element, and it's sitting in some environment, for example, it's sitting in air, right? And you take it out of air and you put it in water, you put it in something with a different refractive index, the modes will change. The resonance frequency is going to change. So if we could put our resonator on top of something that has a very tunable refractive index or a very tunable permittivity, then we can achieve behavior that is tunable. So what we use as our tunable material is we actually use graphene. Now, graphene is a very in vogue material, and it's well characterized, and people know how to make devices with it, which is one of the reasons why we chose it. But also, it turns out to have very widely tunable optical properties, especially if you operate in the mid-infrared, if you operate at wavelengths of like 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 microns. And that's because the optical response of graphene, if you move around its Fermi energy a little bit, is actually just due to the amount of free carriers in the graphene. Right? So a graphene is a very thin sheet of essentially a semi-metal. And if you can control the carrier density on it, then you essentially control, roughly speaking, its refractive index, because you have kind of like a Drude model of the optical response. Right? The amount of carriers affects your metal permittivity. So if we were able to take a piece of graphene and change its carrier density and then put a little metasurface element on top of it, we can tune the metasurface element very effectively. So the way that we can tune the carrier density of graphene is very, very simple. All you do is you'd make a parallel plate capacitor. You put a sheet of graphene, you put an insulator in between, and you put a back contact, and you charge up this parallel plate capacitor, and that puts a charge density that's tunable with the voltage that you put on top of the sheet. And because the graphene is very, very thin, and because it has this linear band structure, you can actually change the carrier density very effectively with voltage, right? Like the thinner an object is, the more the number of carriers affect the sheet carrier density. So it turns out that if you do a calculation, if you calculate the permittivity as a function of frequency, the real part and the imaginary part of the permittivity as a function of frequency, as a function of the carrier density of the graphene, which is sometimes called electrostatic doping. It's not doping in the sense that you don't do any chemical modification, you just dope it by putting a voltage on top of on the graphene. Then if you sit at one particular wavelength, you see that you get a pretty big change of the real part of the permittivity. It starts going from being not very metallic to being very metallic. So you can imagine that putting a metasurface in the neighborhood of this structure will lead to a big change in the resonant frequency of the metasurface element. So this is what the structure actually looks like that we made. This is a metasurface that's sitting on top of silicon oxide, sitting on top of a gate, which is essentially doped silicon, so it's a conducting material. And this is the scanning electron microscope image of the gold antenna structures that we made sitting on top of this graphene. So this is graphene that's been obtained from Jing Kong's group. They grow it by CVD, and this is at MIT. You can see that these antennas are now kind of closely packed to each other. They have very small gap sizes in between them. In particular, this gap size over here is about 30 nanometers, and the wavelength is, you know, 6, 7, 8 microns. And there's an important reason for that. So the reason why we make a gap size that's very small is because even though we can change the optical properties of graphene a lot, graphene is very thin, right? So if you have just an antenna sitting on top of this very, very thin sheet, most of the fringing fields, most of the fields that are near fields surrounding the antenna, are actually not in the graphene, right? They're in the air or they're in whatever is underneath. And therefore, even though we can change the optical properties of graphene a lot, we don't change the metasurface response a lot. So what we need to do is we need to somehow focus the electromagnetic fields, the near fields, into the graphene so that a change in the graphene optical properties gives us a change in the metasurface. And the way we do that is we effectively make another parallel plate capacitor, this time in plane, right? We say, because the antennas have, when they're excited, they have carriers that are flowing up and down along the antenna. And this way, we can make the positive charges and the negative charges be in close proximity to each other. They make a little parallel plate capacitor, and the smaller the gap is between them, the less fringing fields you have. And therefore, the more light you're focusing inside, the more electromagnetic energy you're focusing inside the gap. And so we're able to enhance the interaction of light with the graphene by reducing the fringing fields associated with these antennas. And the results that we get experimentally are pretty good. So this is, for example, in this case, we don't have an inhomogeneous metasurface. This metasurface isn't designed to do anything other than just to demonstrate the resonant behavior, so the elements are all the same, like you don't have any gradients or anything like that. And we're just plotting the reflectance of this entire surface as a function of wavelength. So the reflectance is a function of wavelength as a function of the voltage that we put in on our parallel plate capacitor. And we can see that the reflection peak, which corresponds actually to the resonance of our antenna structures that comprise our metasurface, is actually changing pretty dramatically. It's changing by about 1.1 microns, or about 80% of this full width at half max. And the full width of half max is broad because it's a very lossy antenna. And so this corresponds to a phase tuning when you're sitting at one particular wavelength of more than pi over 3 radians. Now, of course, that's not enough. We want 2 pi, so this is not nearly enough. And a lot of more work needs to be done, but at least it looks like a way forward. It looks like a way that we can get some tunability. And we've been able to experimentally demonstrate switching of this structure at about 30 megahertz, which is, you know, reasonably fast. And at this point, we can start thinking about metasurfaces with nanosecond timescale phase and amplitude control. So going a little bit beyond that, we've actually been able to make to introduce this same type of structure, but with a backplane reflector. And we've designed it to actually, instead of scattering a lot of light, we designed it to absorb a lot of light. And we, at one particular resonant wavelength, you can actually suppress the reflectivity from the structure altogether. In the literature, this is called a metamaterial or a plasmonic perfect absorber. You end up getting a lot of absorption in your metal, and in this case, in your graphene as well. And so by making this absorber, and by making the peak, or the dip, rather, of this absorber tunable with the voltage, we can then move around this peak at timescales that have been estimated to be about 1.2 gigahertz. And you can start imagining that this is a pretty good modulator, for example, for the mid-infrared, or even for the near-infrared, if you're able to get to high enough carrier density. But this is a pretty decent modulator in that your modulation depth is very large, although at the moment our insertion ratio, the amount of light that we're losing in the high reflectivity state, is pretty significant, so it's not kind of like a dumb thing yet. So finally, this is a slide that I added just last night because I've been invited by the NanoBio node. I thought that it would be a good idea to at least talk about one potential application of metasurfaces to biology. So more and more adaptive optics techniques, which have been used widely in astronomy and kind of remote sensing, have been applied to biological imaging because you want to oftentimes see very deeply into scattering media, into media that have lots of inhomogeneities and that scatter a lot of light. And so oftentimes adaptive optics techniques are used to recover signals that have been highly distorted by, for example, multiple scattering through highly, highly turbid, highly inhomogeneous media. So this is for a schematic that I borrowed from the Gold Research Group at Bates, and this is an image that I borrowed that's a very recent image using adaptive optics techniques to image deep 150 microns into the brain of a zebrafish from Eric Betzig's lab at Genalia Farm, and you can see that you can get really, really good images very deep into scattering tissues, and that's very exciting. But oftentimes, the speed of spatial light modulators, which are used to correct for distorted wavefronts that come from all of these multiple scattering events, the speed of these spatial light modulators, which tend to be about milliseconds, set a limit to the number of pixels per second that can be acquired, especially if you're doing scanning, and especially if you're doing scanning over like a three-dimensional volume, and especially if you're trying to image a live process that has certain timescales associated with it, right? So you need to be able to do a number of changes in your spatial light modulator to be able to correct your wavefront quickly enough that you can capture a live process, and that's something that's difficult to do. So you can imagine that if you can have these dynamic metasurfaces that can have switching speeds on the scale of nanoseconds, you know, I've demonstrated 30 nanoseconds and also down to 1 nanosecond, and that's orders of magnitude, many orders of magnitude faster than the fastest spatial light modulators, and you can imagine that you can start unwrapping your fields much quicker than you could conventionally and that are being done now. So I think that's an exciting prospect, even though maybe it's a little bit into the future so far. So kind of to summarize, we can design metasurfaces to impart nearly arbitrary control over the amplitude, phase, and polarization of light. And these metasurfaces can be very thin, they can be very flat, they can be very light, they can be put on flexible substrates because they're very thin and they're bendy. The designs can be scaled all the way from the visible to the infrared, to the terahertz, and to even longer wavelengths. And we've been able to demonstrate so far a number of optical components. I told you about lenses and spiral phase plates, but you can do many other things with them. There's potential for dramatic tunability. So each element could, in principle, be tuned at up to gigahertz frequencies, which is much faster than today's spatial light modulators and much faster than today's screens. And of course, there are a lot of challenges to overcome and a lot of future work to do, and that's in the areas of efficiency, chromatic aberrations, dynamic tuning still, being able to tune big enough, to get a big enough phase coverage. And of course, the biggest challenge of all is doing all of these things at the same time, right? To be able to get an element that's high efficiency, that works for multiple wavelengths, and that can be tuned all at the same time. That would be the holy grail of metasurface optics. And at that point, you really can start competing and even winning over conventional optical elements. So I would like to thank some of the financial support that we've received in the process of this work, and also advertise just a little bit that as of a month and a half ago, I started a new research group and a new lab at the University of Wisconsin, which is sitting on beautiful Lake Mendota when it's not frozen. And it's a fun town, and I think we're going to do cool things, both in the area of metasurfaces and in a number of other topics in optics and photonics. So come work with me if you're interested. Thanks.